something that was kind of quiet.
Compensate.
We compensate, and then what else?
Retract.
We pull away, okay? Anything else what I did? Something? Well, that could be, we definitely want to withdraw from pain. You know, if there's a pain, if there's a stimulus, we definitely want to pull away from it. But what do a lot of us do? We take something that will block the signals to the brain. We block the signals to the brain. We really haven't done anything to heal the area. We're just simply stopping that stimulus. Now, granted, you have stuff like anti-inflammatories, blah, 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 okay? But you need to make sure that there's some type of that pain left over so that you don't continue to damage the area, you know? Think about that, because if you have no pain, you're going to continue doing what you were doing, and there's going to be pain that could get worse or tear, wear, damage, whatever the case. So pain, based on whether the fibers are myelinated or unmyelinated, determines how fast the signal travels. If you remember, myelinated axons, information travels faster. So we say there's fast pain, slow pain. We have pain that might come from something external, but there also can be internal pain. Our organs, the organs of the body, actually can let us know when they are in pain. In our bodies, when something happens for pain to be present, bradykinin is a chemical that lets us know there's pain. And it can be pretty potent. The way that our internal organs are going to let us know that they are in pain or that something is wrong, they basically make an area of our skin hurt. So, for example, the liver, all right, people can come in and have this right upper quadrant pain, okay, and it could be related to their liver. It would alert the doctor to begin to look at a liver panel, for example. You can have, for example, the referred pain of a heart attack. Now, the heart attack symptoms are classic in males, okay? Chest pain, up into their neck and shoulder, and down their arm. In males, that is the classic sign of a heart attack. That's not the classic sign for females. For females, we tend to hurt in the middle of our back, all right? And if you go to the doctor, they tend to poo-poo it, and that's why women tend to die faster or die more of heart attacks than men. You can have a bladder infection, and it can make your legs hurt, it can make your abdomen hurt. Your organs are going to let you know that they're in pain, that something's wrong. So when people have something wrong with their organs, they tend to hurt at a specific area on their skin. And this can help, this can actually be clinically significant because it can help alert the health staff that something's wrong. Our central nervous system has ways to help pain. Now, when these mechanisms kick in, we're going to say these are endogenous opioids. Now, endogenous, what does that mean? What does endo mean? Within. Genus, basically. Within us. Okay? So endogenous, within our own system. Opioids. The body actually produces opioid-like substances. We have enkephalin. What about endorphins? Y'all probably heard of that one, right? They call it, a lot of times, they'll refer to it as runner's high, because the person who does that type of exercise, as they begin to get that run going, once their body adjusts to the environment, like having to take in more air, the production of, you know, the heart rate going up, all this sort of stuff, well, they finally reach the point where things kind of level out and the brain chemicals are getting released. And those are the endorphins. We also have dynorphins. Those were kind of discovered after the fact, but these are those feel good. They're usually associated with the exercise. Now, enkephalin, when there is a huge trauma, car wreck and the loss of a limb, okay? The person may or may not know it.
May not know it.
In other words, they may still feel their limb, but you know it's now severed, okay? In the case of a major trauma, this gets produced 200 times more potent than morphine. Anybody ever in here either experienced morphine or seen anyone experience it? I mean, you know, my mom had both of her knees replaced on the same day. So, you know, she definitely was on the morphine. Well, you know, people tend to hallucinate and stuff like that on the morphine. So, I go to the hospital to see her. She's got a tissue in her hand, and she's wiping everything. You know, she's wiping the sheet. She's wiping the rail on the bed. She's wiping her arm. And I'm like, Mom, what are you doing? Don't you see all the dirt? But huh? She goes, can't you see? Everything is dirty. Can't you see it? There's dirt everywhere. And I'm like, oh, yeah, it is, Mom. How about over here? So she wiped over there. And I went, well, what about over here? She went, well, the nurse comes in. And nurse takes me outside. And she goes, now, you know, when people are on morphine and hallucinating, we try to bring them back. And I was like, yeah, but this is so much more fun. So, it is, you know, so think about having that get produced in your body. And it's a survival mechanism. Now, one of the things that happens, the way that they're going to work, okay, they're going to work by spinal gating. So basically what happens is, as those pain signals try to travel up the spinal cord, they go, nope, can't go any further, can't be recognized, all right? That's how they'll stop the pain. And then once the original trauma is done, then the body can go back to feeling the pain and hopefully the care occur. So that was a general sensation that doesn't get included in that chapter for some reason. But this chapter, the special senses, vision, hearing, equilibrium, smell, taste. If we begin to think about what's going to happen with the special senses, well, like I said, we're going to have to take the stimulus that is coming into these areas of the body, and we're going to have to convert it into something the body can understand. The body understands chemicals. So, good example, let's start with the sensation of taste. Well, probably next to vision, this is my favorite, all right? Especially the one that deals with sweet, okay? I have a definite sensation for that sugar, okay? Now, have y'all ever thought about your taste bud? Really? Why?
Because my mom had a bunny syndrome and she couldn't taste anything else.
Really? Yeah. I've never heard of that. What is that?
Like, okay, so most times people get it from like smoking cigarettes, tobacco use, and alcohol. Which she loves to go to bed. So, essentially, like, it just makes you can't taste it in her mouth. It's called burning tongue syndrome, but her tongue essentially burned all the time. Mm-hmm. And it was just like, she, and then it prevented her from being able to taste it for years.
Yeah, if she had quit,
I don't know if it would have reverted it. If you look it up, you can literally look up burning tongue syndrome. I don't know, but I mean, like, I don't know if it would have eliminated, like, it would have gone back. Per se, I don't know if it's like something that just stays there forever, okay. but I don't know if it's hereditary if you can get it, but I know like one of the main causes is alcohol.
Okay. Andrew, I see you shake your head.
Actually, I guess I sometimes think about my taste buds. Part of me, they exist. It allows me to sample different flavors and different foods. I was a chef for 9 years, so sort of like cooking is like a hobby of mine.
So that probably got more aware doing the chef. Okay, cool. And that's even.
I love food, so I love food.
Unfortunately.
I do too. Okay. Well,
what about when like you smell something and you smell it and you can taste it in your tongue?
That okay. Now. Once we get to the taste of smell, hold on to that thought. Okay? Hold on to that thought.
One thing I always wondered is like, of where people that are raised to spend in the common like
that's
not
the
only one.
Sugar.
Oh, like it's swollen and it happens. Yeah, that can happen. And this is the reason why that can happen. It's because of the structure of the taste bud. The structure of the taste bud is very unique, okay? If we look at this, okay, taste, it's also known as gustation, okay? Now, if we look at the structure of the taste bud, what we're trying to do here, okay, if we look at our tongue, okay, and the structure of the tongue is very interesting, all right? But what we're trying to do is we're trying to show one of the larger taste buds, one of the larger areas, okay? And then show what it can look like closer up. But then if we choose one of the smaller taste buds and blow that one up, okay, and look at it under a scope, this right here would be like what we would see under a microscope, But here's my graphic representation. Now, notice the structure. And this would be a this would be why the taste bud, well, that area could get irritated and, like you said, kind of be swollen and that sort of thing. Because first of all, it is in this tissue of the tongue, okay? And we have openings, so it can get irritated, all right? Now, what has to happen, okay, we're going to what we say happens with the sense of taste is we pick up taste ends, the chemicals, all right?